Hello. And I guess this is good afternoon or maybe good morning. My name is Darby Bailey, and I will be your moderator for today's symposium. Welcome on behalf of the McKinnon Trauma and Recovery Lab, the FACT Project Healthcare Salute. This symposium is called Navigating the Fog, the Role of Healthcare Leaders in Supporting Provider Mental health during the COVID-19 pandemic. I am a journalist by trade, a storyteller by nature, and every now and again, I have the great fortune to be asked to moderate an event like this one. I consider this legacy work, these deep conversations, the research in institutions like McMaster set the agenda for the actions we should be taking and the conversations we should all be having before, during, and deep into the long tail of an international crisis like we are facing with COVID. So I want to thank you for being here. I would like to acknowledge the land that we're on right now. My family came here from Jamaica in the 1970s, and we continue to be ever so fortunate and grateful to have come to this country and be on this land and this territory as immigrants and settlers. I live and work on land that we recognize as the traditional territories of the Haudenosaunee and Anishinaabe nations and recognize and act on the responsibility that comes with that. I'd also like to acknowledge the land on which McMaster University is located, which is the traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee and Anishinaabe nations, and within the lands protected by the dish with one spoon wampum belt. The wampum uses the symbolism of a dish to represent the territory and one spoon to represent that the people are to share the resources, of the land and only take what they need. Further to that, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission's 94 calls to action reaffirms that the treaties with Indigenous peoples must be lawfully honored. We are all treaty peoples and are responsible for honoring and upholding those agreements. Again, welcome to this symposium. Now, over the past close to 4 years, we have heard much about the strain on the healthcare system and on healthcare providers due to the pandemic. But those providers are not rudderless. They are steered by leaders, and it's impossible to paint a complete picture or look to solutions without looking closely at leadership and how leaders can better support their teams. Today, we will hear from researchers from across the country doing the work to quantify and pinpoint the pressure points for those working in healthcare and offer up valuable solutions and best practices. We will hear personal stories, dig into the challenges and concerns from the perspective of leaders and healthcare workers. Today, we have two leaders who were in the front lines during the height of the pandemic, John Yip, who is the CEO of SE Health, and Dr. Heather Morrison, PEI's Chief Medical Officer of Health. So today is about sharing knowledge and experiences and marrying that with deep research, which hopefully leads to a cultural shift. Learning and adapting through crisis is a true mark of leadership. If you're a healthcare worker and/or occupy a leadership position and you're watching right now, we truly can't thank you enough for your service. So, some of what you might hear today might be difficult to process. There will be links to wellness supports. They're linked here in this video, but there will be in the chats as well. So, take a look at that if you feel like you just need a break. And thank you to the Public Health Agency of Canada and all of our partners for their commitment and support. This symposium is being recorded as part of the broader research project, so you will have the opportunity to look back at this symposium if you miss anything. There is an open chat function for this virtual event. Please be respectful in your interactions and try and keep the chat on topic, but it is open there for everyone to use. You know, maybe right now, just drop in the chat where you're coming from, where you're at right now, at geographically, not spiritually. We don't have to get into all of that right now, but if you just let us know where you are by dropping that in the chat, that would be great. That's where we'll be interacting. We'll also interact in the Q&A. So if you scroll onto your Zoom, you'll see something called Q&A along the bottom. It's to the right of the record button. You can drop questions into the Q&A because there will be question and answer periods after each session. And the chat is going to be updated throughout the symposium by Sangeeta. Thank you so much, Sangeeta, for doing that. Ancaster, hello, the Regina campus. Good morning. Hello from Sudbury. Lots of folks tuning in. I love it. And we have two sessions, I should tell you that, today, one in the morning. We're going to take a short break at about 12. We have two sessions in the morning and then one in the afternoon. We're going to take a break at 12 and then we're going to come back after that. So if you want to take a break then, that's great. Hello, Calgary, and hello, Winnipeg. Okay, now with leadership at the very top of mind, I'd like to now welcome Dr. Margaret McKinnon, the team lead on this project. Hello and good morning, Margaret. Wonderful to see you.
It's wonderful to see you, my friend, I would say. And, you know, I would be, I think, really remiss if I didn't start by thanking Media Girlfriends for their many, many contributions to this project. Garvia, Hannah Sung, and their teams have traveled across Canada, conducting interviews with healthcare leaders, frontline healthcare workers, along with public safety personnel, to really tell the stories of those individuals who faced the challenges of the pandemic head on, who served at the front line as leaders on our hospital floors, in ambulances and fire trucks and police cruisers throughout the pandemic. And Garvia and Hannah have really worked so hard to tell the stories. And I just want to thank you, Garvia, for everything that you've done, and Hannah. I also want to thank our production team, Make Things Well, who has really been an incredible partner in this project, who created our website, who has supported us throughout. I just wanted to acknowledge that in this symposium series, because we haven't done that before, and I really did want to do that. I want to also thank John Yip and Dr. Heather Morrison for being here today. We so appreciate you being here. I want to also say that, you know, I had the honor and the privilege of serving on the front lines during the pandemic to provide mental health supports. And I spent time in the COVID-19 units, on medical floors, supporting staff, but I also spent time with the senior leadership teams in the board of my mental hospital board, and also seeing the challenges that leaders faced. And I think at times it was difficult for people to know and appreciate what leaders also experienced. I have been in rooms full of tears because there's so many hard decisions needed to be made. Oftentimes leaders were seen as the face of something that they really had no control over. Decisions were often changing in the moment. I am an academic leader, and I know we would make decisions and within seconds they would change. So I just want to also really thank Dr. Morrison, John Yip for being here, but also to say thank you to all of Canada's healthcare leaders. You also made many services and many sacrifices, as did your families, and we just want to thank you for that. I also want to quote something that John said during a video interview that was conducted with him earlier, that's posted on our healthcare Salute website. And John said, you know, I would never ask anyone to do something I wouldn't do myself. And I think that is really the marker of service among leaders. You know, they also went in, they served, their families made many, many sacrifices. Often they weren't able to go home at night. They stayed there. You know, I can recall being on a COVID-19 unit for 36 hours, the majority of that spent in a storage closet, because it was the only time when people had a chance to take a break and receive mental health support. And leaders were in those same positions. So I just want to acknowledge that. It's really, really important to acknowledge your service and your sacrifice as well. So I'm going to now introduce Aneesh Joseph, Dr. Aneesh Joseph. And Aneesh Joseph is a member of our Trauma and Recovery Lab here at McMaster. He received his PhD in social policy from Southampton University, and he joined us recently in our group to conduct research and also to provide, you know, I think real leadership around knowledge translation. So bringing that research to Canadians, trying to shape and influence policy and healthcare practice through that work. Aneesh spent much time also working as an addictions counselor as well. So in addition to his research training, he's also been on the front line. I really just want to thank Aneesh most warmly for the work that he's been doing and all of the Healthcare Salute team who have really been supporting this project. I think it's an important time to acknowledge everyone's contributions, and I really want to do that. So we'll turn it over now to Dr. Joseph. Aneesh.
Thank you, Garbia and Margaret. Hi, all. Thank you for joining us today. I am happy to present the findings of our research on the role of healthcare leaders in supporting provider mental health during COVID-19 pandemic. At the outset, I would like to thank the team at Trauma and Recovery Research Unit at McMaster University under Margaret McKinnon and all the healthcare workers who participated in this project. Since February 2021, a dedicated team at the lab have been working with healthcare workers across Canada to research, analyze, and document the impact of the pandemic on the mental health and well-being of the healthcare workers and generate helpful tools and interventions to support them. The findings can be accessed on our Healthcare Salute website. These extensive research prompted us to look at the organizational culture within the healthcare sector and look for areas and elements that need to change for creating a better work environment that supports the healthcare workers' mental health and well-being. The concept organizational culture represents loosely how things are done here and how that affects the way members think, feel, and behave. So cultural change will mean moving from current state to a preferred state of how things are done here. This presentation discusses some of the key elements of the current state of organizational culture and also will present recommendations that came from the data to support how we envision a culture change within healthcare organization. With this intention, we surveyed and conducted semi-structured interviews with healthcare workers from frontline, middle management, and leadership. The data have been thematically analyzed and will be presented today. These are the demographic information, age, provinces, and profession of the 24 healthcare workers who we interviewed for the survey, for this study. We used organizational culture assessment instrument to understand and gauge how the members are thinking about changes within the organization. OCAI scale is based on competing values framework and looks at four modes of culture within the organization and seeks to understand the kind and direction of change they wanted to happen within their organization. Clan, adhocracy, hierarchy, and market are four different segments within this framework. Preliminary analysis show that there is a strong desire to move towards clan that represents collaboration, connection, trust, communication, and a reasonable aspiration to incorporate adhocracy, which represents innovation, cutting-edge services, and growth. It is important to note that the data shows an equally strong desire to move away from the current market orientation and hierarchy in the organizational culture. The qualitative data expounds the intensity and depth of this need and aspiration for organizational culture change. We will be discussing the major themes and sub-themes that emerge from the data, and we'll be presenting them as themes and recommendations. While COVID-19 challenged everyone in the organization in different ways, the healthcare workers acknowledge and appreciate the work that the leadership and management did to steer through the difficulties of pandemic. They also unpacked some of their concerns regarding the way current organizational culture is constructed. Three major themes emerged from the data that can be considered as challenging aspects of current culture: widening disconnect, mismatch between words and actions, misalignment of priorities. Theme one, widening disconnect between leadership and frontline. Disconnect is delineated in words and phrases such as distrust, invisible, unavailable, lack of presence, lack of transparency, and lack of understanding, unilateral decision-making, hierarchy, feeling done to or treated as a pawn. This disconnect was pronounced in the way decisions were made within the organization. There are considerable aspirations for engaging leadership that is present, visible, and accessible. Theme two, mismatch between words and actions. Words without actions were perceived as superficial, disingenuous, and lip service, especially when it comes to supporting the mental health of the staff. These mismatch between words and actions were considered to be eroding the trust within the leadership. Fear of retaliation has been identified as a strong deterrent that prevents staff from being open and from voicing their perspectives, concerns, and genuine feedback. That contributes to how they experience the organization as a place where their mental health is not supported. Theme three, misalignment of priorities. There's a perception that the staff and leadership have divided priorities. While the organization wanted to be run like a business, the staff wants to prioritize patient care and self-care. This division, this divided priorities, keep them focusing on different aspects within the organization. And that focuses their energy in caring for different areas of the organization and its culture. Being in rudderlessship suggests the experience of lack of direction, initiative, and collaborative leadership. This has been an experience of, especially when people came out of the pandemic, they wanted strong direction to move everything forward from what has been going through. And staff experienced a lack of leadership initiatives in many aspects of organizational culture. Some of the recommendations for moving towards a desired organizational culture are as follows. The first recommendation is rebuilding trust and fostering connections. The organization needs to initiate processes and procedures that can rebuild trust and enhance connection within the organization. Rebuilding trust and fostering connection can help the frontline staff to feel heard, listened to, supported, and provide them with a sense of belonging to the organization and its work. Second recommendation is matching words with actions. The organization need to devise ways and take ways to take accountability for matching their words and actions, and also create ways to communicate those with the staff. The organization need to create mechanisms for ensuring that the values, policies, promises that it claims to stand for are adhered to in the everyday dynamics of the work environment. The third recommendation is prioritizing wellness, safety, and mental health of the staff. Following through critical incident debriefing, promoting self-care for the staff, Facilitating mental health support, preferably on-site, and providing systemic support such as manageable workload, proper staffing, and higher allocation of funds for mental health in the benefit and compensation package can all help to embed these changes within organization. When we really take these changes seriously and work towards making it happen and making it embed within the organizational culture, that will definitely lead to a trauma-informed organizational culture and work environment, and towards a trauma-informed leadership. Thank you so much. With this, I conclude my presentation. I will now turn it back to the moderator.
Thank you so very much, Dr. Aneesh Joseph. That was wonderful. And really, some words that are sticking out: present, visible, accessible. I feel like that presentation does an excellent job of providing context and conversational fodder for the discussions that we're going to have today and the discussion that we're about to have right now with two healthcare leaders. Now, I should preface all of this by saying that this is not putting these leaders on the hot seat. This is not a session that is meant to put their feet to the fire, because I've spoken to both of these leaders at length, and I know that they provide the kind of leadership that the models that Dr. Joseph are putting out put out just now, they very much adhere to this. And I think it's just talking about their experiences being on the front lines during the pandemic. John Yip is currently the CEO of SE Health. During the height of the pandemic, John was the CEO of Kensington Health, a community not-for-profit healthcare provider in downtown Toronto. They provide community-based long-term care, hospice, and ambulatory programs. Thank you for being here, John. And Dr. Heather Morrison is the Chief Medical Officer of Health for Prince Edward Island. Dr. Morrison has also worked as an emergency room physician right up to the beginning of COVID. So her experience spans not just being on the floor, but being one of those leaders that a whole province was looking towards for help. And I should add that the province itself loves Dr. Morrison. They really do. They named a chicken after her. So I don't know who else can say that, but Dr. Morrison can. Thank you both for being here. I want to start with a question for both of you about Dr. Joseph's presentation. Was there anything in that stood out or surprised you to learn any of this? I'll start with you, Dr. Morrison.
Good morning, good afternoon. It's Quay. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm in Charlottetown, Prince Edward Island. And so nice to see from the chat people from different parts of this wonderful country. I think... You know, when I hear Dr. Joseph speaking, I think the COVID pandemic highlighted and brought to the fore many issues that were already there before, and they highlighted them. So, you know, when we probably did not have the best supportive environment for our mental health of our healthcare workers before COVID, and after COVID, we needed more than ever. And so it really, it wasn't that it surprised me, but I think emphasized the fact that along with many other parts or things that happened during COVID, it really got highlighted.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. For you, John, was there something that jumped out about Dr. Joseph's presentation?
Well, I wish I had a chicken named after me. I think there's a pig somewhere running around Ontario named after me. I am based in Toronto. Thanks for inviting me to this session. I think it's critically important that we talk about these things. And I quite enjoyed listening to the snippet, the video there, Dr. Joseph. And I agree with Dr. Morrison's comment. You can almost hear and read that paper pretending that COVID never happened and that those findings would be exactly the same findings pre-COVID. And it would be just buried and no one would really pay attention to it. If there's any good that came out of COVID, there are a couple good things despite the tragedies involved, is that the plight of our frontline staff, the mental health and well-being of our frontline has been put to the forefront. And even now, dare I say, post-pandemic, it is still a major, major issue. And the pandemic did shine a light on these issues that pre-existed and continue to exist right across the country for our frontline healthcare workers.
Yeah. You know, I had, as we've mentioned, I had the pleasure of speaking to both of you in person over the course of the summer and spend, you know, probably too many hours sitting in front of you asking you some very pointed questions. And one of the questions that you both talked about moments in which you realized that there was a shift in what was happening, that this pandemic was something that was unique, and that perhaps the way that you were approaching leadership might have to shift slightly. Can you tell me about what was happening? Can you paint the picture of when you realized that this was something that would require something maybe that you hadn't had to kind of like dig into post COVID? I'll start with you, Dr. Morrison.
Well, I mean, and our experience here in PI, I will preface it by saying it was different maybe in our province compared to some of the other provinces. I think there were a few things. One, how we managed when we realized how long this could last. I think that was a big key thing. This was not going to be over in 8 weeks, like a SARS kind of journey. It was going to be much longer. So how we were going to get through this and looking further ahead. I said this at this different time, so it may not have been at a certain point, but we knew early on that we would not always make the right decision. But and looking back, we knew that we would make mistakes, but we knew we had to make the best decisions with the information we had at that time and make them for the right reasons. And if we were doing that, that would help us going forward. For us in PEI, when Omicron came, almost 2 years after the pandemic started, that was a huge shift for us, because up until for almost 2 years, we did not have a death. We had hardly any hospitalizations. We did not have a long-term care outbreak. But with Omicron, how we managed had to shift. And we also had to lead differently to the public, because they weren't used to seeing COVID. We had to adjust with government, with our partners, and with the team here in the office. And so that was probably one of the biggest times of changing, knowing we had to change to learn how to live with, you know, we heard often have to live with COVID. And for us, that was really when Omicron came. But it was like the worst of the pandemic for us here came at least when we had vaccines and some of our processes and PPE in place. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, actually, those were some key points.
Yeah, for sure. John, for you, I know that there was a time in which you spoke to your staff at Kensington Health at the time and said that we have to do things differently. Can you just paint that picture? What was happening during that time when you realized that this was something unique and would require some different skills from you?
Yeah, sure. Just to give people context, Kensington Health has a 350-bed long-term care home on its site. It's one of the largest homes in downtown Toronto and well sought after. The waiting list is 5 years long. It's a lot of demand for the home. And I think mainly because of the fantastic quality of care the teams provide there. So when I went up on the floor, this is the day after the WHO declared the pandemic, and even leading up to it, I think around end of January, someone had the foresight to dust off the pandemic plan, and we kind of had a look at it in January. That was the sort of turning point number one, is we had not updated our plan. We looked at our stock of masks. We had 3 days of N95 masks, and we decided we better start doing N95 fit testing. So that was like a big moment. And organizations do N95, particularly in long-term care homes, on an annual basis. So this was not anything new. But fortunately, our director of care had the foresight to do that. The second sort of shift was going up on the floor and seeing the staff. And this was day one after the WHO declared the pandemic. And we had masks. We were wearing masks. And you could tell the fear in people's eyes. You just look, went up on the floor, and there was silence. Then there were tears. No one was talking. There were tears. There was, you could see the fear. You could feel the fear on the floor. The staff were begging for universal masking. This is, again, way before any province, country had instituted universal masking. And I couldn't tell them that we only have 2 weeks supply of the masks. Like I couldn't tell them that, because if we instituted universal masking, we'd run out and then we wouldn't have any masks. So having that internal debate and be able to look our staff in the eyes and say, look, we're going to have to just make do with what we've got. And we're going to have to put our residents at the forefront, despite how you feel. The next day, I go back on the floor, 70% of the staff had left, walked out, called in sick, went on vacation. And we've got two 25-unit sections with four staff total managing. That's not even enough staff to manage one 25-bed unit. And that's when the real panic started to kick in, and we went into overdrive.
Mm-hmm. You, Dr. McKinnon mentioned a quote from you that you wouldn't ask of your staff anything that you wouldn't do yourself. And I know that a part of the story you shared with me is that you went on the floor and did the work that was necessary just because of that shortage. And I wonder about those sorts of decisions. Like, I know that pressure comes to both of you from above as you're trying to manage all of your staff. So I wonder about a decision like that, how crucial it was, and how you think that that decision was seen by those that you were leading, John.
Yeah, so the overdrive was, we got to staff up. These residents aren't getting fed. They're not getting changed. They're not living their best lives. In fact, they're living their worst lives. And we know from the news what happened to, unfortunately, many long-term care homes. And that was top of mind. This is even before those tragedies. I was like, this is a tragedy in the making. And I'm not a clinician. I'm not even trained to be a personal support worker. In fact, I realized the only skill I have is one of a residential aide, which is to feed our residents, which I did. In any way possible to help. And then it was a call to action. It was a call across our organization. We have a ambulatory surgical side. We have community supports. We have a research arm, and called a town hall and said, look, I've been on the floor for 36 hours straight, feeding, doing labor, cleaning, doing a lot of cleaning. I think the floors were cleaner than my own floors in my own house at the time. And I said, I'm on the floor. We need your help. Who's going to volunteer? 20 hands went up. We had a research assistant, clerk, someone from the finance team, three nurses from our surgical division, which were who were amazing. Lined them all up, split up, and got to work. I think that action alone spread to the families who, at the time, I think people will remember, no visits, no visitation to long-term care. You know, the iPads, the faces against the window, remember that? The families heard about this, and one family member proposed, why don't we go in and work too? And I said, that's the craziest idea ever. You know, the union will be against that. Our lawyers will fight against that. You know, very administrative response. Can't do that. Call the lawyer, call the union steward. Within 24 hours, we had 20 family members on the floor working as staff, as temporary part-time, earning $17 an hour as a residential aide. They already knew the people on the floor. So they were more than happy to help out. You know, what's amazing too is all those family members donated those wages back to the organization. They didn't keep it. It wasn't about the money. It was about serving, and it was about taking care of their loved ones and the loved ones of others. And that, to me, is what community is all about.
Mm-hmm. But it's also, you know, an example of leadership in knowing that you had to get rid of these barriers. Like, that is on you to remove the barriers so that people can actually help. So that is one of those visionary things that was happening during that time. Dr. Morrison, we talked this summer about your team, and Dr. Aneesh's research talked about trust and about building trust. And I remember clearly you saying that there was a certain moment in which you felt that you had pushed yourself too hard, and perhaps you had pushed your team too hard during that. And that is in retrospect and looking back. When you look back at that, what do you think might have helped you in being aware that maybe the push was just too hard? Is there anything that could have prevented that looking back, you know, pushing way, way, way too hard for yourself and your staff?
Well, I mean, I heard one of the staff say to me, you know, I'm only working this hard. Like, I'm staying here, missing my family, here all weekends, late at night, because I see you doing the same thing. Mm-hmm. And that's what I think it means, that I can be here too. Because if I didn't see you working this hard, I wouldn't be able to be here. And at the time I thought, okay, well, that, you know, this is what, how we trust each other. We all work together. We support each other. But maybe that was a sign that I wasn't doing what was best for them either, again, in hindsight. But, you know, we talk about things that were there, not there before COVID. We did not have the surge capacity that we needed to manage any kind of crisis. And we certainly don't have that now. And just at a time, I think, and maybe this will come up later, I mean, but just at a time when we really should be putting more resources and human resources to help make the system better, it's just when I have fewer staff than I ever did in the height of COVID. But we really need to recognize that surge capacity. But that trust is really important, and how we create trust with our teams, with the politicians that we serve, with the public, and trying to make sure that we had regular, open, transparent, honest communication was really, I think, what I tried to do with the team and with the public. And that meant that we showed emotions sometimes. And I wouldn't recommend crying on TV because it's sort of not a great look, but it happens. And it happened in front of senior officials. It happened with my team. And it also happened in the public. Because it is emotional, it is about fear. But I think in doing so, it allowed for some really honest communication and trust at a time when we all needed that.
You know, I would highly recommend if folks are listening to go to the videos that we shot with Dr. Yip, with John Yip and Dr. Morrison. You knew I was going to do that, and have a look at their stories, because it's a very, very deep stories of their own fears during that time. And I wish that we had another hour to get into all of that, but the videos, I think, do a great job. Dr. Joseph's research outlined three themes that emerged in the research: a widening disconnect between healthcare workers and leaders, a mismatch between words and actions, a misalignment of priorities was the third. And you know, I think the pandemic set the table for these issues to emerge. But as you both have said, these are issues that have been ongoing. It just so happened that, you know, this is an opportunity to look at all of it all at once. What methods did you use to help maintain trust with those you were leading during such a stressful time? John?
Yeah, I think the old phrase of actions speak louder than words really played a key role. Same example as Dr. Morrison. If staff see you doing what you're asking staff to do, it models that type of behavior, and it's okay to be able to be vulnerable. It's okay to share your fears, which I did on a daily basis, because while I work in healthcare, I am not trained to do any of this, particularly when there were deaths where funeral home providers weren't allowed into the home, and two very tiny PSWs and I would bag the body, the individual, not in a dark body bag that is typically done, but in a transparent plastic, and writing their name and time of death on their face while you see the face, and wheeling them out in the hallway, empty hallway, and into the front where there's a little bit more staff, into the hearse that's waiting. The staff looked at me and said, "I've never seen a CEO do this." And I said, "Well, I'm not the CEO right now. I'm here to help. I'm just trying to help, trying to keep everything together." And doing the manual hard labor that our teams do every day, they see this every day within, outside of the pandemic. It has given me a huge appreciation for the bedside care and the care that happens before people come in and when people leave. And I think that perspective has made me a way better leader in terms of really narrowing that gap that Dr. Joseph talks about, really saying things that I mean and will do. If I won't do it, and if we're not going to do it as an organization, I'm not going to say it. I'm not going to commit to anything. I'm not going to be that bobblehead leader, which I think I was pre-pandemic, mm-hmm. You know? And as a young staffer, I would look at leaders and just roll my eyes at a lot of the things leaders would say. And I didn't want my teams to look at me that way. So I think really getting into the trenches like Dr. Morrison did is one way of endearing that trust. You know, you've done the hard work together. You've shared these very intimate details about yourself. and you carry that through post-pandemic. And I still maintain very close friendships with many of the staff, some of them who are still at Kensington, others that have left, and ironic, some of them have joined SE Health. I still maintain very, very close relationships with them. We don't talk about the pandemic. We talk about our families, talk about life, the good things in life, even though we've experienced a lot of not so good things during the pandemic.
Yeah. Dr. Morrison, what about you? You know, now you are still, you know, leading the province. You still have your staff with you. What have you done to help to maintain that trust and build that trust after such a stressful time?
Well, I mean, during the pandemic, it sort of became the phrase I'd finish every press conference with, and people started wearing T-shirts and putting it on billboards like "Be patient, be kind." Mm-hmm. And I've put it up so I can look at it every day to remind myself, because I really want to lead us as a group post-pandemic with some of that same thing. Be patient, be kind, and we had to be patient and kind with ourselves, because it was really hard. And I think even for me personally, I underestimated how long it would take me to sort of come out and how much it impacted my own mental health. And of course, and the team that I work with and have the privilege of working with all the time. So I think, as John said, it's, you have a different bond with people you spent that much time with and you worked with. And even as a collective, as a population, especially in the, you know, through that first part, to have that collective sense of what we were doing. We were all working together in PEI and as a team to try to protect our community and our healthcare system. And I'm not sure I'll see that sort of collective action and that thinking about others in quite the same way. And it was really amazing to see that. And that cooperation between so many different partners, and whether it was restaurants, businesses, long-term care facilities, and our team all working together and forging those partnerships. So those are the things. So talking about how do we maintain that trust, it's about maintaining those relationships that were really important and that helped us, you know, achieve some really amazing things during COVID. So how do we make sure that some of that can continue for the months and years ahead as we struggle with a precarious health system and increasing demands from our population?
Yeah, for sure. I want to open up the floor to questions, but I do want to talk to, so the Q&A section is right there. If anyone wants to drop in questions for John Yip and Dr. Heather Morrison, we're open to that right now. But I do need to talk about mental health, not for just, I know the two of you struggled yourselves personally. I wonder if you are thinking about the mental health of your staff and yourselves differently now that we're in this long tail of the pandemic. How are you thinking or rethinking mental health now? Dr. Morrison, can I start with you?
Well, I think healthcare workers and including public health officials were subject, besides all the hard parts of the pandemic and what the whole community was going through, we were subject to some harassment, bullying, threats, and vitriol that really we hadn't always experienced before. And I know that impacts us in a terrible way.
You had people at your door, like protesting you at your door. I mean, that is pressure. Like,
yeah, and we had, you know, loud protesters in groups with loudspeakers and drums outside our windows here at the office for days and weeks. We had people come to my home. We had RCMP, we had police calling me saying there have been threats, where are your children? We had, you know, they told me I couldn't go anywhere by myself. I didn't go out to eat with my family for almost 3 years. I didn't go to a grocery store. I mean, that's some of those are for me, but I think as as healthcare workers, there was so much kindness we saw, but we saw some real hard things too. And we were subject to people or to some having some threats and vitriol, which I think this is the time. So I think about how can we protect healthcare workers and public health officials in terms of legislation, in terms of policy before the next crisis, and even in without a crisis, how can we do a better job? Because it is really hard what healthcare workers do every single day, and we certainly don't need that added element to impact us. And long-standing percussions when there is threats to yourself or to your family. And we are doing our jobs, so we should be protected and be able to do our jobs in a very safe environment and not be subject to that.
Yeah. Thank you so much for sharing all of that. John, what about you? Have you been thinking about mental health? You have a new position now with SE Health. You're in a leadership position once again. How are you approaching mental health, and how are you approaching your own personal mental health after such a after this crisis?
I would admit this. Mental health and well-being for staff pre-COVID maybe was not the top three things that I focused on. I'm going to admit that publicly. You know, I think leaders have a idea it's important, but you know, you got budget pressures, you've got government policy changes, you know, all the other things that take up your time. And so I will admit it was not in the top three. In my new-ish role, it is number one. It's largely with the sector that I work in now, home care and long-term care. 80% of the staff are racialized women. Many of our staff struggle to put food on the table with the wages. They have families. They have cars to fix because it's home care. And they carry a burden of not just caring for their clients, but the burden of taking care of their family. And I would say broadly, as a healthcare system, don't really invest or pay attention to it the way that we should. And it's no surprise. We see, you know, thousands of frontline workers leaving the system. Why we have packed ERs and hallway medicine. The crisis that's faced in healthcare is not just about underinvestment in new infrastructure, new programs and services. There's that. But there's just been a massive exodus of people that we ignored. In Ontario, there was a controversial piece of legislation called Bill 124, which capped wages for public sector employees and was only just repealed by the highest court in the province last week. Well, if your wages are capped and you're working 36 hours, you know, serving the public, and your wages are capped and are purposely capped, why are you working that hard? So, you know, for me, it's very interesting. Yesterday was a big day of full back to back meetings, 6 hours of inclusion work. And we are, as an organization, going to invest in wellness. And we have, when we look at our benefits now, it's not trying to find the cheapest plan. We're going to invest in giving our staff the necessary supports they need. Whether they need them or not, they should have access to it. And so we're being very intentional about addressing this. And then for me personally, it's interesting. Like, I kind of joked before in the practice call that, you know, I blocked this out. This 3 years I blocked out. And I was running the other day in the forest, and I just stopped and started crying for no reason. Like, I couldn't understand it. I just really couldn't understand. It's happened once before when my father died. It was many years later that it happened, and I realized I actually hadn't talked about it. I didn't want to acknowledge it, and it just came out. And I went to talk to my family. My partner is in healthcare too, and I told her this, and she just said, I think you've got a bit of post-traumatic stress symptoms years later. And I didn't even realize it. And so part of participating in this session and with you in the video series, and I've talked about it with you, Gavira, is that I didn't really talk about it. I didn't feel the need to talk. I didn't want to talk about it. I didn't want to do this. Mm-hmm. But I think I'm so glad that I've participated. I'm glad there is research being done on this, that it's critically important to be able to share these thoughts, experiences that kept bottled in. And I didn't realize what an impact it had on me until that run in the forest.
Yeah. Thank you so much for sharing that. I want to just ask each of you, we have a couple minutes left, for each of you to have about a minute for this huge question that that Dr. McKinnon has posed. What would you tell future leaders who face these same challenges in the future? What would your advice be? Dr. Morrison?
I was wondering if I had to go first.
You could just throw it to John if you really want. You're allowed.
I just wanted to pick up, before I answer the question, pick up on John. I mean, I think you're so right. Sometimes I focused on thinking that other people wanting to make sure we had lots of sort of mental health debriefing for post-COVID for teens and others, but I didn't think I needed to participate in them. So I recognize that because and only later did I realize that every time I talked about some of the issues, I would start to be super emotional. Anyway, so I certainly appreciate that, John. I think one of the things I would say to future leaders is that our decisions always need to be balanced. So the impact of our public health decisions, I'm not sure we always got the balance right, because it's really hard. You're trying to save lives, but we also had huge impacts on mental health. And to be more cognizant from the very beginning of that kind of balance that we need to have going forward. I think recognizing the need to have the capacity built into our healthcare systems and public health system to manage these crises, which will continue to occur, and because if we don't have that surge capacity with not enough people, they work so much that it does impact their mental health, and then we can't continue. So we will protect everyone better and if we have enough to manage it in those search situation. And then I think I mentioned that maybe the final comment is around it's important to do this research, to talk about it, to have these sessions, even though I would like to sort of not talk about it sometimes because I want to move on, but it's exactly what we need to do so that we can learn and that we can create environments that make us more resilient and healthier this interpandemic period. And that includes making sure that we are protected and not and don't tolerate any kind of bullying type of behavior in any sense for us as healthcare workers.
Yes, thank you, John. You have a message to future leaders.
It's hard to top that. No wonder why Dr. Morrison's got a chicken named after her. Thanks for going first.
She earned that. She earned
she
that.
Did, definitely. Definitely. I would say two things. And one is use TikTok. And it sounds funny, but the point is this, is use the communication tool that the people you're communicating to will use and absorb. We had done your typical PPE types of workshops and people would still not don and doff properly. And we came up with a 15-second TikTok video with dance moves and so on. And guess what? Adoption rate of donning and doffing went like shot up to 100%. So I think as a leader is, and I think Dr. Morrison does it well, and her public health colleagues right across the country are amazing communicators. They take very complex issues and articulate it in very simple ways so that the public can understand. So number one is communicate well, use whatever mode is appropriate. In my case, since we had a younger workforce, everyone was using TikTok. So communicate often, simply, and again, and again, and again. Number two would be, you know, Jay-Z said this when he accepted his Grammy. And I subscribe to what he said. He said in accepting his award is to show up. And it's as simple as that. As a leader, show up. Show up when it's hard. You don't need to show up when it's great. I think there you'd allow others to shine. But your job as a leader is to show up during those very difficult, very, very uncomfortable situations where bad news is horrible. And when good news is great, let others take that on and you can stand in the shadows. But I think there are many people still, leaders, don't show up. Don't show up for their staff. Don't show up for their clients or their patients. And that's not being a leader. So it sounds very simple. Jay-Z has a way of being simplistic, but he's a very, very intellectual guy. And when you unpack that, there's multiple dimensions about showing up. Showing up as a friend, a family member, a leader, partner, father, whatever, mentally, physically, like it is very multidimensional. And I'll let everyone kind of nod at that and what that means.
I love that.
Maybe JC was following some of the words of even Winston Churchill from a long, long time ago. It just made me think of it. Churchill describes really anyone can, not anyone, but you can lead more easily in good times. But it's when things are harder that it really takes true good leadership. And I think that really is about showing up. And it is when things are harder that you have the leadership that you really need. So maybe JC and Winston Churchill were connected some way.
Let me tell you, two things I did not think were going to show up in this chat. Jay-Z and maybe Winston Churchill, I'm not sure, but I love that they both came together. And I so appreciate both of you, John Yip, Dr. Morrison. Thank you for taking the time to be here and be so generous in talking about leadership in this way. I know it's not easy to reflect back and think about the things that you wish you would have done, but your generosity in sharing your stories is just so appreciated in this forum. I even went over time. I'm only going to give people three minutes to rest and come back. But thank you so much for this. And with that, I will leave everyone to leave. Maybe we'll give you 6 minutes, and then we can come on back and start our session again. So see everyone back here at about 1:05. Thank you, John, and thank you, Dr. Morrison.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Very nice to be back again with you. Welcome back for those who are joining us or just joining today's symposium. It's entitled Navigating the Fog, the Role of Healthcare Leaders in Supporting Provider Mental Health During the COVID-19 Pandemic. Now, in our first session, we were presented with findings from Dr. Aneesh Joseph. We also spoke to two leaders in healthcare, John Yip and Dr. Heather Morrison, who gave us firsthand accounts of what it was like to lead at the height of the pandemic. It is so clear that in order to face the ongoing challenges, some would call it a crisis in healthcare in the wake of COVID-19, we not only need to hear stories, but we also need the research. We need the empirical evidence, we need all of those things. To talk about their research, we have some incredible leaders in research. Dr. Kim Ritchie is here with us. Dr. Ritchie is an assistant professor in the School of Nursing at Trent University. She completed a PhD in rehabilitation science from Queen's University, focused on understanding and identifying the clinical presentations of PTSD and dementia in older veterans. Since joining the Trauma and Recovery Unit at McMaster in 2020, she has also co-led the program of research that underpinned development of our PHAC, our FAC-funded Healthcare Salute Initiative. To this day, I've been working with you guys for so long, and I still don't know if I should say FAC or PHAC. I need to get with the program. Dr. Jenny Liu is also here. Dr. Jenny Liu is a postdoctoral associate with the McDonald's Franklin OSI Research Center and an adjunct research professor in the Department of Psychiatry at the Schulich School of Medicine and Dentistry at Western University. Dr. Liu's background is in the science of stress and resilience, so important. She works with stakeholders to identify the determinants of resilience in different communities and supports efforts to promote or build resilience using a number of evidence-informed strategies and approaches. And Dr. Dayna Lee-Baggley is also with us. Lee-Baggley is a registered clinical psychologist in British Columbia, Alberta, Ontario, and Nova Scotia. She has an active research program on behavior change, obesity, chronic disease, professional resilience, and acceptance and commitment. Again, if you have questions for our research panel, please put it in PHAC or FAC. We don't mind. Okay, thank you, Shannon. I will say it either way. If you have questions, please put it in the Q&A portion. I'm sure you will have questions for these researchers. Welcome to all three of you. Thank you for being here. I think the best thing to do right now is just to ask you, each of you, to give us just a little bit of a Cole's notes on a little short synopsis of your research projects and maybe just a little bit about the findings, and then we can go from there. Dr. Ritchie, can I start with you, Kim? Is that okay?
Yeah, absolutely. It's so nice to be here. And thank you, Garvia, for the warm welcome. It's a real privilege to be part of this panel and to be talking about such an important topic. And Aneesh's presentation and the discussion that just happened with John and Heather was so important and so moving. And I just want to thank them. So for our research, as part of the Trauma and Recovery Lab, we have been doing research for just over 3 years now, talking to healthcare providers, and we have now completed interviews in 126 healthcare providers from right across Canada, and we've collected surveys from over 1,000. And so we've really, you know, come to learn a lot about what their experiences have been through the pandemic. And I think one of the things that we've really learned about that I think is relevant for the discussion today is about the how impactful organizational support is on the mental health of healthcare providers. And when I heard John specifically talk about how, you know, prior to the pandemic, I think we knew it was important, but maybe not in the top three or in the top 10 sort of priorities. And so I think we've really learned now about how important this topic really is, and how much the work itself really takes a toll on the mental health of healthcare providers. We all spend a lot of time at work, but I think, you know, for healthcare providers, they see a lot of really difficult, sometimes emotionally stressful things as part of the work, and we don't talk about it enough. And I think that's been something that now we're starting to talk about it a little more, which is a really positive thing.
Great. We are going to circle back and talk about your findings shortly. But Dr. Liu, what about what you're up to with Revel?
Sure. Thanks, Garvia. So it's a pleasure to be here today. And, you know, every time we talk about Revel, I kind of have to dial back a little bit and talk about kind of the background of how we arrived here. So we're also a PHAC or FAC funded. Thanks, Shannon. we're also PHAC/FAC funded project. And originally, our research center specializes in military research. And so what we set out to do was adapt the resilience training for the military, the R2MR program, or the Road to Mental Readiness program, and adapt it for healthcare context using an implementation science framework. So focusing on adoption, focusing on implementation. And part of that process was identifying who's, you know, our target reach or target audience, and then doing in-depth work with them to figure out what are their needs so that we can customize that adoption. And during this process, it dawned on us very quickly. So Road to Mental Readiness is essentially a program, you know, there's modules, there's kind of self-learning, self-directed training, and all of those things. And our learnings were, you know, in the midst of the pandemic and all of the sort of the subsequent effects, healthcare workers don't want any more modules. They're already inundated and overburdened as is. And the last thing that anyone wants to do is to take more time from their daily lives, probably not reimbursed, to log on, do more module, to do self-directed learning. So that was kind of one of the big learnings. And then also, most of the stressors that were identified during that process of deep discussions were organizational in nature. So it wasn't a lack of awareness of mental health strategies. It wasn't a lack of yoga-ing that was, you know, contributing to their organizational burnout. It was very much the organizational policies, the rapid changes, the feeling like your organization doesn't have your back. All of the things that we've just heard in the last hour, those were the themes that emerged. And that was why we couldn't just say, okay, let's just stick with our original plan. Let's adapt the R2MR. So we want to actually shift our approach and essentially want people to revel in the work that they do, want them to re-engage with the organization. And how we do that is by working with organizations to reconceptualize and transform the way that they think about well-being support, right? Is it just that we throw a bunch of, you know, individual level things at these healthcare workers and some hit and some don't, and, you know, and look at where they stick? Or is it that we just transform the way we think about well-being and the role of the organization and the role of leaders? And that's very much the work that we've been doing in the past 2 years.
I love that. I love that because Dr. Joseph's presentation talked about a cultural shift, and that's what you're talking about. It's not just the modules and teaching people. It is shifting culture, which is can feel like an iceberg, I'm sure, but we'll talk about that. Thank you. Dr. Dayna, can you tell us just a little bit about the work that you've been doing?
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for having me. So I'll just focus on the work kind of relevant for this topic. So I was a frontline worker during the pandemic. I was working on the medical, surgical, and cancer care teams at the hospital. In wave one, I got redeployed to give therapy for frontline workers and medical first responders of the shooting in Nova Scotia. And then in wave two, I was working in the cancer center. And so we got some funding to do burnout in frontline workers with my colleagues at St. Mary's University in industrial organizational psychology. And similar to Dr. Liu, I was like, we are not going to tell these people that they just need to do more yoga, or if they just did more mindfulness, everything would be okay. And so we chose to do leadership training, because leadership is a way that you can address some system level problems and your fastest way of doing that. And so we developed, you know, a training program. We've now tested it, you know, in three randomly waitlist designs, both in home care workers as well as physicians. We did it during the pandemic. So in our weekly data, you can see here's where wave three hit of the pandemic, and showed that we could reduce their own burnout in voluntary indicators of stress, like their resting heart rate, so that we could address some of those system level problems. The second thing that we did was we did an intervention on moral injury for nurses. And so we are working with people who work in the military to work on moral injury. There was a lot about that, you know, potentially being a problem for healthcare workers. And so we did an intervention with them as well. And a lot of similar issues about that have been mentioned already about the institution not being there to protect them, the institution failing them, that those were often the sources of the moral distress and the moral pain that people were experiencing. And so what we've really been working on now, as a psychologist, I spend most of my time helping individuals, right? But then somehow like sending them back to toxic workplaces. And I was like, I really just want to fix some toxic workplaces for a while. And so we've really been working with workplaces on having comprehensive mental health strategies, which for the record is not an EAP, right? Those are lovely. You should have them for sure. But that is when the crisis has already happened. So we focus on how do you put fluoride in the water? How do you embed this in your everyday actions? And so we think about, you know, trauma-informed leaders. We think about psychological safety in the workplace, that these are the organizational factors that we need to address. You don't want to rely on help-seeking behavior of employees. Like, so we always want to empower employees, but we really need to be targeting those systemic organizational factors. And that's really what we've been focused on. And then lastly, I get so frustrated because when I started working in corporate land, they just make stuff up. I'm not kidding you. Like, there's not a lot of research there. So in healthcare, everything has to be evidence-based. Like, you have to, you know, you don't just get to make stuff up. But in workplace, like mental health, there are tons of people who have just come up with their own strategies, their own ideas. It's not tested. There's no theory. And I was really shocked by that. And so it's also become our mission of like, how do we increase access to science-based information? There's a lot of good research and it is not getting to the people who need it. There is like this major delay between research and implementation. And so we also work on that, is how do we get more access to people so that they can stop suffering? Like, we know a lot of ways to help people, and it's really not getting translated fast enough into everyday lives.
That was like a mic drop moment right there, Dr. Dayna. Thank you very much for that. We keep circling back to systems, and I'm really interested in Revel and what you are doing there, especially within the military, Dr. Liu. I had the great fortune of talking Major Bocage, Mary Lou Bocage, who led some of the first teams that went to Wuhan and brought back Canadians. She's just this incredible leader in the military. But she talked about the systems. She talked about the pressure that she gets from above, and the need for the whole kind of system to lock into place. So I'm wondering about the what is the most urgent need on systemically, if you could just wave your wand, Dr. Liu, and say, this is what the system needs. I know this is a big question, but what needs to be addressed urgently right in this moment before the next crisis comes?
Oh, tough question. So I think I want to unpack that a little bit, right? So mm-hmm. first, we're talking about, you know, the all the work done in the military, and that's a huge system, you know, lots of different kind of channels, lots of different moving parts, and an old institution, right? And yeah. take that and apply it to healthcare, and you've got the same challenges, right? You've got bureaucratic channels, you've got, like, you know, it's institutions that's been around, and you've got a lot of moving parts with not a whole lot of cohesive sort of glue to tie them together. And that's really one of the fundamental challenges, is that the system was inherently broken well before a pandemic even hit, right? And any kind of lack of acknowledgement of that is not true, right? We're not, it's not like pandemic created these problems. It just magnified and amplified all of the challenges that we face now. So things like shortages and resources, not having, you know, a wellness vision or wellness strategy, all of those were in existence. And so that's really the fundamental challenge. It's about how do we transform wellness and inject it into this institution and all of its moving pieces. So Dr. Lee-Baggley, you talked about, you know, a wellness strategy. That's so key. That's one of the challenges we're toying with anytime we're partnering with an organization and thinking about wellness at an organizational level. It's, for some, it might mean that, you know, well-being or staff well-being wasn't even in a mission or a vision statement. Now, if that's the case, let's just kind of play that out, right? What does that look like? It looks like, you know, at the highest level, where a lot of these decisions regarding resource allocations are being made, someone doesn't have that within their mandate to do so. Mm-hmm. And so then where do you squeeze out the time, the effort, the resources, the focused attention to attend to wellness, right? Mm-hmm. Someone somewhere down this cascade chain needs to be responsible. And where do you see that? And if that's not a vision or a mandate, how do we then highlight it and make others aware so that it becomes a strategic priority? Mm-hmm. And in the presence of a priority, you know, what does that look like? What does that strategy look like?
Mm-hmm. I think you answer a question right there that I'm going to pose to Dr. Ritchie about focusing on leadership, because when you're looking at the stream that's coming down, where can you, you know, where can you be the beaver to put in the stop? Let's look at this first. And the beavers in this case are leadership. It's the leaders. This is why this is happening. So Kim, I'm wondering if you can tell us what the research is telling us about the mental health of the leaders themselves, because there is, if we want to help these leaders to implement these things, I think that there is a crisis within the leaders that I spoke to, for sure, in their own mental health. They're having their own mental health challenges. What were you hearing in your research across the country?
Yeah, that's exactly it. And I think, you know, we interviewed frontline, middle management, and senior management, and I think they're all struggling with mental health. And I think that, you know, the point about it, things were already very broken before the pandemic, and things are just amplified now, along with this amplification also of the mental health struggles across everybody. And one of the things that we've been working on to try to address this within the leadership is taking the idea of trauma-informed care. And I think, you know, most healthcare providers are familiar with trauma-informed care because it's something that we're very trained to do for our patients and clients. But it's sort of taking that and turning that to the employees and staff and people themselves and embedding that. And how do we embed that into an organization and train leadership and train frontline staff to embellish and integrate these ideas of trauma-informed care? In the prior presentation, we talked a lot about trust. And I think that's one of the really primary things that we're all talking about within the system. You know, how can we develop greater trust and safety within our organizations and with our leadership, between our leadership and frontline, and between each other within teams? And I think that's the real foundation of trying to rebuild these connections and trying to rebuild the organization in a better way, hopefully, than even before the pandemic. I think sometimes it takes a crisis to create these changes. And we're really at this point now where we have to make these changes. So addressing this from sort of a systems level of how do we look at the organization in embedding something like trauma-informed care, but how does that trickle down to each level? And what are the responsibilities then for the leadership within that? What is the responsibility of the frontline? Because I think we all, in any organization, there's a responsibility for everybody to integrate those types of standards for each other.
Well, that brings me to that question of uptake, especially within leadership. Dr. Liu talked about the fact that there is, that people don't want modules. They don't want to spend the time. They don't want to spend the resources. They don't want to, but in order to implement some of this, it has to start somewhere, and there has to be some kind of uptake. Even Dr. Morrison, who we spoke to earlier, she said, my first instinct is I want to move on. I don't want to talk about this stuff anymore. We need to move on for, and I think that is a very natural humanistic way of thinking of a crisis, but that is not possible. So Dr. Dayna, I want to ask you about that, about the uptake in some of these programs that we're seeing coming out of this massive influx from PHAC, from FAC, to try and implement, to create these systems. What about uptake? Like, what is needed to jump that shark of, here's the stuff, how do we get people to just start using it?
The opportunity is that when people are in crisis, they're more willing to change, right? So a lot of the work we do is really on the behavior, like the science of behavior change. And so, for example, when we're teaching something about psych safety for leaders, we're breaking that down into behaviorally, what does that look like? Like, we have all these concepts of be a trustful leader, be an authentic, what does that look like? Behaviorally, what do you need to do? And one of the things that we do in all of our work is, why is this important? We try to find value-driven reasons for change. And in our theoretical models, values are about what you want to give to the world, not what you want to get from the world. So they're about how you want to show up, right? The kind of leader you want to be, the kind of employee you want to be, the kind of partner or parent you want to be. And so we're always trying to find that motivational reason for change so that it doesn't become a check the box kind of activity. When you can find value-driven reasons for change, then it's a sustained change. So there is a ton of data on the ROI when you invest in mental health. Like, there's just a huge amount of data saying if you invest in mental health, your numbers look better. Your productivity is better. Your retention is better. Right. But sometimes that data isn't enough. I think we also need to talk to leaders about what kind of legacy do you want to leave? How do you want to be seen as a leader? How do you want to be known or recognized? Because when you start caring about people's wellness and their mental health, then people start being loyal. People start wanting to do, extra. They want to be there and they're well enough to stay, right? I left after wave two for my own burnout reasons, right? Mm-hmm. And, that maybe was like canary in the coal mine, but also we never said the canaries had to be more resilient, right? Canaries in the coal mine is that, like, the environment is toxic, right? You need to fix the environment. And so I think we need to start thinking about, again, there's a ton of signs of behavior change. How do you get people motivated? How do you get people ready for change? How do you support them in the behavior change aspects, both for employees and for leaders and for organizations about who they want to be? There's a huge HR, crisis in healthcare, where there's not enough people to do the work, and we're just burning out the people who remain even faster. And so we need a radical shift in terms of what kind of organization do you want to be? How do you want to be seen by your employees? And making wellness you know, as the previous speaker said, like the top priority, like employees are always going to be your most valuable resource. And we actually, you know, prior to the pandemic, we would apply for research on resiliency in healthcare workers and we wouldn't get funded. And the feedback was, this isn't patient focused enough. So taking care of your employees, your staff, your healthcare workers isn't patient focused enough, right? We need to see these not as separate things, but what you need to do good patient care, right? So we talk about when you're well, when you're charged, when you have energy, who benefits from that? It's not just you. It's also your patients, your colleagues, probably anyone you interact with because, you know, we're less grumpy. And so we need to connect these motivational reasons for change. And again, there's a lot of science we could be using to help make those changes.
Yes. I would just love for either one of you, Dr. Liu, or for Dr. Ritchie to jump in on this, because I think there's a lot to build on here in talking about how we jump it into actual action, implementation of these things. Dr. Ritchie, can we just start with you? I'll throw it at you. The implementation of the systems that need to be in place. How do you see that rolling out, having done the research and now seeing what leaders are thinking and feeling? Are they ready for it? How does it happen?
Yeah, I think that's such a great question. And it's such a hard answer at the same time. I think we're in a space now where there's this, I think you said it too, where there's this sense of let's just get on with it. And, you know, the pandemic's behind us. We're just going to get on with it. We'll do things the way that we have done them before. And we'll just get going along that same train. And I think it's really hard to stop and to say, you know, we're not going to do it that way, that we're going to intentionally make a new change. And I think that that takes a lot of courage. That takes a lot of that's kind of a really sort of hard place for people to be in. So I think we have to sort of start showing that there is something to be gained by doing these types of things, that there are positive outcomes that we can build on, and that employee mental health is a not just an individual responsibility, but an organizational responsibility. I think, you know, we've all talked about the research. We've all talked about our own research and the wider research that really shows that mental health of employees, if you have better mental health, you don't have the turnover, you have higher retention, you have better patient outcomes. You know, we have seen that in our own research where we have many healthcare providers were about 1 in 2 saying that they are intending or have an intention to leave their organization and or profession. And so these numbers are staggering and they're really scary. You know, one of the turning points, I think, for me during the pandemic, when I was learning about what was unfolding, was in a conversations that I had during interviews. And healthcare providers said, you know, the pandemic's taking a real toll on my mental health, and my family, my friends are all saying, you know, it's time for me to leave. I need to walk away from my job, but I don't want to leave. I want to be here and I'm really good at my job, but I need my organization to help me to do my job better and to keep me here and to take care of my mental health. And so I think, you know, if there's any sort of first thing, it's that idea of leadership in an organization prioritizing the mental health of their employees. And I think Dr. Dayna mentioned that as well, is that has to become the first step that we have to do. And I think by showing, you know, through resources, through changes in the way that we connect and deal with each other, by offering more than just EAP, offering more resources. There's a lot of healthcare providers who have no mental health resources or extremely limited. And I think those are the places where we can really start to build trust, to build connections, and to show this type of caring that we need to do to build our biggest resource in healthcare through our employees. And in turn, as others have said, then we're going to really help our patients too. And we're going to be better humans in our personal lives, in our professional lives.
For sure. But our leaders buying in? Like, are you getting to the people that need to be reached in order for this change to happen. I think that that's where I'm getting stuck personally in listening to everyone, is that, is it getting to the right people? I think Dr. Morrison and John Yip are, they might be exceptions. I'm not sure, but I'd like to know if the work that you're doing is getting to the right people, Dr. Liu.
Absolutely. And that's an important question. And, you know, working with our partner sites in the mm-hmm. project that we do, and whether we're speaking with middle management or whether we're speaking with, you know, C-suites, executives, the CEOs, the messaging is the same from them. It's that they care. They want change to happen. They recognize that there's challenges. Where the disconnect often comes from is from, you know, the kind of the different levels, right? As it trickles down, things are not necessarily communicated. So even from the earlier session this morning, we hear about difficult decisions being made and rapid changes. And those kinds of decision-making and the kind of struggles are not communicated in a transparent way. And so that's where the cultural shift is. That's where the front line feels like no one has their back, while their leaders might be trying very hard, working with the limited knowledge, the limited resources that they have. And so solutions of yesterday, right, where we focus on, you know, individual levels, or we focus on, you know, doing patchwork of here and there and trying to fix the solutions, they're not going to actually help share that information, bridge the gaps. And so one of the things I'm hearing from both Dayna and from Dr. Ritchie, is that the struggles and of yesterday, like getting funding for a project that focuses on implementation, that focuses on the employee experience, you know, those things are not, they weren't funded before, but now they're being recognized. And so one thing I want to highlight is that, you know, what got us here to this point is not going to get us to the next stage. And so transformative change is required. Change is required, meaning that, you know, whether it's funding opportunities, they need to recognize it's not about a simple pre-post intervention design anymore. It's about implementation, system transformations. And we're starting to see from researchers' perspective, more opportunities that are geared towards that type of setup, right? At the beginning, even when we were doing a lot of our projects, the funding opportunities didn't look like what it did now. And it's going to take a leg change. On the leadership side, they're also now recognizing that it's not just a top-down decision model that's going to, you know, have the maximum impact on employee well-being. It's going to take, you know, a horizontal approach where people feel represented, where frontline, the staff, the people that are on contracts, everyone as part of an ecosystem feels like they're seen, feels like they're heard, feels like they're valued. And that's the type of solutions that need to be designed and pushed forward for things to change.
And
again, just to reiterate back to your question, leaders want those type of solutions. Leaders are open to hearing about the evidence. And, you know, there's tons of that available. It's just about how do we translate that? And here where we kind of go back to communication, right? It's about that communication. How do we communicate decisions? How do we communicate that leaders care and that things are being done, are being planned to help, and that we want to transform, we want to change.
You know, that beautifully brings me to a question about the next steps in your research, where the research needs to go next, and how the next steps in your research will build on what you've already, on the momentum that you have with each of the individual projects that you're working on. So what happens next? What would you ideally, it sounds like there is a buy-in. This is a great time, you know, as Dr. Morrison said, we are inter-pandemic. We're in the inter-pandemic period right now. Thank you for that. And we're preparing for better responses for whatever comes next. What is the next phase in the research that needs to be implemented. And I'll start with you, Dr. Dayna.
Yeah, for sure. So, we actually partnered with a tech company. We created a tech company to create a scalable science-based solution. And so we came up with an app because that's a nice scalable science-based solution that's full of science called Impact Me. And the resource is in the chat. But we did that because we feel like we have enough. The science in our app is based on 1,000 randomly controlled trials of how this therapy, impacts a wide range of things. And it's, out of my comfort zone to be like a co-founder in a tech company is not something I ever envisioned. But I would like my mission in life is to help reduce human suffering. And it's not going to happen through one-on-one therapy. Right. That's partly why I left the hospital. I was doing one-on-one therapy with cancer patients, clearly a deeply meaningful thing to do, but the mental health needs of the planet had gone up in wave two. And I was like, one-on-one therapy is not going to cut it. And so there's a lot of science. We need to be implementing it. We need to be partnering with people who know how to get these systems into corporations, into organizations, into hospitals, into other places so that we can actually start having an impact with all this knowledge that we already have. And so that's what we've come up with as a solution to, again, increase access to science-based information. And I think that it is this like implementation, partnering with people who know how to do it. Researchers actually are not great at it because we're great at the research, but it's not our skill set to necessarily bring it to the people who need it. And so we need to be partnering with the people who do know how to do that to like get it into the hands of the people who need it most.
Of course, I have to do that every Zoom, at least every Zoom I have to do at least once. Are you seeing some of that happening? Is it getting into some hands? Is it in action? And what does that action look like?
Yeah, so, we have, an early version of the app available. And so we start the conversations. And really, this is from a motivational perspective, from clinical psychology, you start with the people who are most ready. We talk about like a traffic light, you can be green light, you're ready, yellow light, ambivalent, red light, not ready. Start with the green light companies. There are companies. And I would not actually describe healthcare being one of the ready companies. They're a little more yellow light and red light. But there are other organizations who have absolutely bought into mental health being important for their employees and willing to invest into their employees. And so we start with them. We start with the people who are most ready. Healthcare is always in a crisis, and so they can never be forward thinking. They often are not proactive because they're always dealing with a crisis. And I hope that crisis helps motivate them to do something different. Healthcare, and like in lots of places, certainly in my province, kind of looks like a dumpster fire, but I'm hoping that maybe if it just burns down, we can build something better because the culture needs to change, the attitudes need to change. And I'm hopeful about that because I think we can be hopeful in possibilities, right? That there is such a crisis now that maybe people will start investing in their employees and trying to retain them and not just, think that you can just find as many workers as you need. And so we get lots of good feedback, because the app is dealing with burnout for leaders and burnout for employees. So again, we're targeting those system level problems through leadership training. We get lots of good feedback on it. And, we've created it in a way that is viable to be scalable to help a lot of people. Ask me a year from now how it's going. Hopefully it'll be really great and everyone has access to it. Again, to me, it's about helping to reduce human suffering and increasing access to science-based information. And so taking a big leap out of my comfort zone as a researcher to then try to offer something that's viable to the public.
That's great. I want to open up the floor to questions as well for our researchers. So the Q&A tab is there for you. If you have questions, please put them in the tab. Dr. Ritchie, I'm going to continue the conversation with where you see the research going for the Trauma and Recovery Lab. What needs to happen next? This is a big chunk that you've bitten off, a lot of interviews being done. What happens next?
Yeah, so that's such a good question. And so I think, we sort of are taking sort of a multi-pronged approach. I think for our next step, we have learned a lot during the pandemic. We've talked to a lot of leaders, a lot of frontline healthcare providers, and I think now it is about implementation and evaluation. So, you know, taking what we've learned, especially around things like the culture change and the culture shift, that I think we've all talked about today, the trauma-informed care lens that we have learned a lot about, what are the barriers and facilitators to implementing those types of principles into an organization, and how do we go about implementing that and scaling it up? And then I think really importantly, evaluating to see how are these things actually working for the organization, and are they making the types of changes that we're hoping to make across the board? So I think that for us in the Trauma Recovery Lab, that's one thing that we're really focused on and thinking a lot about is how do we implement some of these things. We've also, the other thing we're working on is trying to put together a lot of resources for the frontline healthcare provider who's struggling and just wants things, and for the leaders. And so we're trying to tailor different resources for them through our videos and through other things so that we are coming at it from a couple different ways, looking at it from a structural component, a structural way, but also for the people that are, you know, working day to day and just need some of those resources and help and want to see themselves. You know, the worst thing is to feel like you're the only one who's struggling. So I think by, you know, starting these conversations like this symposium today and through all the work that everybody's doing, I think it's starting to make that feeling of they're not so alone.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that. Dr. Lee, what about the next steps for the REVEL project and for research in general? You know, we are not out of it. There is going to be other waves, other crises. What needs to happen next? Where do you want your research to go moving forward?
Absolutely. And it's, you know, my answer is not going to be dissimilar to what Dr. Ritchie, Dr. Lee-Baggley said. You know, change is uncomfortable. Change is uncomfortable, especially when we're working with system transformations. And one of the things that we're really trying to work hard at is how do we make these efforts evergreen? How do we sustain and maintain this momentum of change, right? When crisis hits, everyone's motivated. Everyone recognizes that, you know, things need to happen, things need to change. But when things get better, that's when we often default to what was comfortable, what was known. And so the challenge has always been, right, when we're working with an organization, how do we embed ourselves to help them, but have them remain autonomous in the way that they maintain and sustain these transformations? So working with them to, you know, asset map their available programming, to transform their vision for well-being, to help them understand what are the roles, what are the transformations, setting up short-term, long-term plans. Those are the things that we want to support organizations in doing, but not directly do for them. And then at the same time, taking the learnings along the way and embedding it back into what we call a REVEL framework, which is really a set of methodologies for working with organizations. And so that's why we're continuing the work for, and we hope that, you know, this kind of work will continue to be prioritized, whether it's by funding, whether it's through communications, through, you know, channels like this, where we have a panel talk to get this information out to others. We hope this is a topic that continues to be prioritized.
Mm-hmm. You know, that there's a question here that I think is really important. We have a couple of minutes left, and I want to think about this question, because there are right now, we're probably, you know, everyone in this room, we're preaching to the choir. Everyone is kind of on the same page. We're here because we want to talk about a very specific thing. But if you're a frontline worker and you're hearing about the research that you're doing and the app and all these things that can be implemented by their organization, how does a frontline worker encourage or push forward the idea that change is needed. They have to talk to their leadership about it. It's just a whole other level of pressure for a frontline worker to have to say, these things are out there in the world. Can we think about them? So what kind of advice might you give someone like that who wants to see Revel somewhere, wants to see the app somewhere, you know, wants to get that research into their organization? What kind of advice would you give them? Who wants to start? This is the only time I'm going to make you guys decide. The only time for the last question.
I can take a crack at it since you mentioned Revel first. Right. But, you know, one of the things going back again, change is uncomfortable, but, you know, solutions need to make everyone feel seen, feel valued, feel heard. And so as a frontline worker, sometimes the first signs of burnout comes from, you know, feeling not as attached, feeling disengaged from your work. And actually, the opposite of burnout is not necessarily resilience, right? It's about meaningfully engaging with the work. And so sometimes it just takes conversations, whether it's with your manager, whether it's with your colleague, about things that are happening at work. And so we can, you know, initiate some of the sparks that will lead to some transformations or some discussions, right? Baby steps here, but it's about not disengaging, mm-hmm. and about taking a step, a step in, leading with, you know, what you value, right? And starting that conversation.
That's great. Thank you.
Yeah. Dr.
Dr. Dayna, go ahead, please.
Yeah, I'll add that, which is, you know, one, connect with other people. You know, an individual can only make system level change with other individuals. So connect with other people who believe the same things as you do, that are thinking the same way, so you have that support, because groups do make change and they make change all the time. So don't be hopeless about it. It happens all the time. Think of all the things that we have changed in the world, right, through groups deciding that they want to change. The other thing you can do is to model the behavior yourself, right? We had some great role modeling by leaders today about being vulnerable, about sharing their challenges, about being authentic. So, you know, we can role model wellness ourselves, which sometimes in healthcare is about placing boundaries. It's about, you know, recognizing that my well-being is in the service of my patient's well-being, that I can't, you know, I can't be unwell and really serve patients well. And then finally, this is what leadership is. Leadership is making the hard choices. You know, character is who you are when it's hard, not when it's easy. And so leaders need to step up and say, these changes need to happen. And you need bottom up and top down to make these kinds of changes. Leaders need to step up and say, we're just going to do it. We're going to do it. And we're going to support people through this change. And it's necessary, because that's exactly what we need to have happen. And that's what real leadership would be.
Yes. Dr. Ritchie, you have 1 minute.
Yeah, I think, you know, very similar, same lines. I think, you know, work together with your peers, trying out what works for you within your peer group, and then scaling that to others in your unit or in other units, or taking that to your organization. I think those types of stories of saying, you know, this has worked well for me, you know, why don't you try it? And then it just starts to build and it becomes a momentum of its own. And then if you have a group of people who are able to say, you know, I've tried this app, or I've tried this particular type of website, and this is where I go to get my resources, those stories are very powerful. And I think that's a way to engage others in the conversation and ultimately engage your leadership and your organization. Mm-hmm. I think everybody's looking for answers. And I think these are types of ways that we can, you know, give our own testimonies of, these are the things that are working for us. And those, that's very powerful, I think, for an organization to hear.
Amazing. Thank all three of you so much for your generosity, your knowledge translation, which I think is such a key component for organizations, having all of this research and then being able to translate it into a way that makes sense for folks to implement is huge. So I want to thank you all for taking part right now And for those in the audience at this symposium who took part, a very lively chat happening. I love this one from Daniel that says, Dr. Liu said it correctly, staff do not need more modules. Enough is enough. Yes. You know, thank you for everyone taking part and being really open to these conversations. I appreciate it. I'd like to now welcome Dr. Margaret McKinnon back for some closing words on this symposium. Thank you all again.
Thanks so much, everyone. I want to just offer our most heartfelt thanks. Thanks, rather, to everyone who participated today, to hear the stories of leaders and to hear the personal costs that came with their sacrifices, and also what we can learn from what happened in the past to make a better emergency and pandemic response for the future. Thank you, Dr. Morrison. Thank you, Justin, for sharing, or John, rather, for sharing your stories. We could not be more grateful to you. I want to also thank our expert panelists. And just to say that again, I think as Dr. Morrison talked about, we're in that inter-pandemic period or inter-crisis period right now. And I think there were a lot of lessons that were learned as we started to mount a response to the onset of the pandemic, where we didn't have enough PPE. We weren't prepared with psychosocial or psychological responses for healthcare workers, public safety personnel, our military members, our veterans, and even for the public. And you know, as we have this maybe grace period that we're in right now, how do we move forward to ensure that the next time we're ready? Because we had the SARS pandemic, and I think we learned a lot, but we didn't always take the opportunity to leverage those lessons. And if we can do so now, we're going to be so much farther ahead the next time this happens. But all that said, you know, I think we can reflect on the systems level, but we also need to reflect on the individual level. So thinking about the individual sacrifices of healthcare leaders, the sacrifices of their families, the sacrifices of the front line. I think when we think about how do we recognize that, we recognize the individual and their contributions, and then we recognize at the systems level as well, what we need to do to change that system. I think it's just a remarkable conversation, and I just want to thank everyone so much. And I want to end by also thanking Christina Steff, Sangeeta to Singh, Andrea Brown, and many others in the Trauma and Recovery Lab who contributed to putting this information together into the whole of the project as well, along with Garvia, Make Things Well, and others. I just want to say thank you from the bottom of my heart. But at the end of this, I just do want to say we salute you, Canada's healthcare workers, your leaders, and we thank you for your service and for your sacrifice, just as we would to military members and veterans who have stood on similar war footing over many, many generations in Canada. This was another generation that faced that challenge, and we're so grateful to you. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. McKinnon, and thank everyone else. Thank you, everyone, for taking the time to be here today. We hope that you are leaving with helpful takeaways. Thank you for taking part in the chat. If you want to leave one word in the chat right now about how you are feeling about this session, please do. Half of you have already gone, but if you want to just drop something in here, just to a word of appreciation for our panelists today, taking the time and putting in the effort to chat with us. Thank you again for joining. Have a great day. And Dr. McKinnon, last word is yours.
One last thing. We must thank the Public Health Agency of Canada as well for their support of Healthcare Salute, of this symposium series, and for really the efforts that were mounted as well to support all Canadians. So thank you to the Public Health Agency of Canada as well, and to our healthcare workers, our frontline leaders, and our frontline staff. Thank you.